The plane is about to take off. Ladies and gentlemen, please fasten your seatbelts, put your tray tables, seat backs in the full upright and locked position. You're going to need to power down all of those electronics. We are taxiing flight WCS 2013 is about to take off again. We've got a terrific dinner session for you, let me say. Some of you picked up the word that Governor Mike Huckabee's flight from New York was a little behind, but the governor is in the car right now on the way here, obeying all Colorado speed limits and traffic laws. And he will be joining us very soon. Raise your hand if you've been to all four summits. Look around. Now raise your hand if you've at least been to one other summit. Wow, it's great, a mix of old and new. Well, some of you at Western Conservative Summit 2010 in the Marriott and Lone Tree will remember that the first prayer of the first summit was delivered by our dear friend and benefactor, member of the Board of Trustees of Colorado Christian University, and co-chair of the Centennial Institute Business Council, our dear friend, Kaylin Foti. We'll ask Kaylin to give an invocation for our dinner right now before you begin your salad. And I understand that it is a special day in history, the 60th anniversary of the end of the Korean War. If you're a veteran or active duty military, on your feet, please. Applause, thank you. Thank you, those who have served our country. Remain standing, and now let me ask that all of us would stand for the invocation. Kaylin Foti.
Heavenly Father, this is indeed a day of thanksgiving, and most of all, praise to you. We praise you for all the people who came here. We praise you for our speakers. We praise you for our panels. We thank you, Lord, for the food that we are going to partake in tonight. We ask that you bless it to our bodies. We ask that you nourish our souls by the power of your Holy Spirit. And Jesus, please be our guest. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you very much. Everybody be seated. I have to apologize for the paint-spattered canvas and the paint buckets and brushes up here and the drop cloths. I'm still trying to find out what's happening here. This is sort of below the standard of the Hyatt Regency, but bear with us. As soon as we have an explanation for this embarrassing paraphernalia behind me on stage, I'll relay it to you, be assured. But I guess it sort of symbolizes a work in progress with improvement to result. And the same could be said about a topic we visited at our luncheon, and that is the topic of, is there a work in progress with improvement to result in Colorado's governor, Colorado's chief executive, whom we will choose between an incumbent and a challenger in 15 months, November 2014. We heard from two friends contending for the Republican nomination for governor at luncheon today, Senator Greg Brophy, former Congressman Tom Tancredo. Want to welcome now someone else who has expressed an interest in the governor's race and who is doing a magnificent job for us since he upset an incumbent Democrat and began tightening and cleaning up Colorado's election processes in an era when the other side doesn't shrink from cheating in elections and voting. Please welcome Colorado's chief election officer, a great friend of Centennial Institute and the Western Conservative Summit, the Honorable Secretary of State of Colorado, Scott Gessler.
Thank you, Thank you very much. I'd like to speak about maybe some broader themes this evening. You know, I read the newspaper today, and it's not hard to see where liberal policies lead. They lead to Detroit, not a pretty sight. Massive unemployment, illiteracy, and a breakdown in social order. And I say this because, to me, it's a little bit personal. My parents are from Detroit. They were effectively made in Detroit. And they came of age in the 1950s, when Detroit was the world's wealthiest and most innovative city. Today, large chunks of it are uninhabited, much like 1701, when Antoine Cadillac founded a small settlement named Detroit. So I speak to a lot of people every day, and they're intelligent, and they're aware, but they're not politically active in the sense that they're not coming to events like this. But there's a common worry and a common concern. They're worried that we're headed towards Detroit's fate. And they are pessimistic right now because our long-standing leaders have eroded the foundations of our greatness as a country here. The good news I see is this. From adversity arises opportunity. In talking with people, I see there is a deep yearning for a bold vision, a yearning for courageous leaders who will break the shackles of a stifling government, who will fight for liberty, who will celebrate personal achievement, who will teach and inspire future generations. Detroit shows us that we need to change course. So my message here this evening, today, is a very, very simple one, and it's this. We, here, today, in this room, are the ones who have to lead the way. And so after these great speeches and after these inspirational discussions, I ask you this. Use this inspiration. Use it. And let us go forth with love and with resolve in our hearts, and let us work to remake our world anew. It is both our opportunity and our duty. Thank you very much, and God bless.
Secretary Gessler, thanks very much. You know, they've called him the honey badger, a combination of sweetness and toughness. Boy, do we need that in our elected officials. Certainly our secretary has stayed, and indeed great things await as he continues his public service. The same can be said of Senator Brophy and Congressman Tancredo, who addressed us this noon. Western Conservative Summit's regional wing spread just keeps increasing. We're very pleased that we have state legislators with us this evening, not only members of Colorado's own General Assembly, who will come and greet you in a few minutes, but from our neighboring states of Wyoming and South Dakota, and further north to the border, North Dakota. We'd like to give a couple of minutes to each of these neighbors fighting the good fight for liberty and limited government in other Western states. So we'll hear from South Dakota State Senator Larry Roden, then from Wyoming State Representative Lynn Hutchings, and then from North Dakota State Representative Kim Koppelman. Larry Roden is bidding for a U.S. Senate seat in South Dakota, and I'd like you to know his vision, and he will no doubt be enlisting your support. Larry Roden.
Well, thank you. I want to start by saying what an extreme privilege it is for me to be here. My wife Sandy, we're guests at the table of Mr. and Mrs. Mike and Brenda Baller. Thank you for your hospitality. What a privilege it's been to get to meet all of you and have such a large group of common-minded people. I am Larry Roden from Western South Dakota, born and raised on a cattle ranch. And about a year ago, my wife and I were approached by a group of gentlemen, including Bob Fisher, and I think Bob Fisher must know everybody in the room, about considering running for the U.S. Senate. And for a year, my wife and I have thought about that and prayed about it, and I have to say it's probably the most difficult decision I've ever made. We announced formally 2 weeks ago that I would be seeking that office. And what it boiled down to for me, as I cleared through the fog in my mind of what this entailed, you know, my family, going back to my ancestors, my granddad fought in World War I, my father fought in World War II, I had a brother in Vietnam. I have a son who's currently learning to fly Black Hawk helicopters in Alabama. And it occurred to me that their service and sacrifice was grounded in the fact that they knew that they were fighting for something much greater than themselves. I feel the same calling. I wouldn't be standing here today if I didn't feel called to service. Because what the situation that we're faced with in the United States is too great and too dire, and we should not be satisfied. In South Dakota, one of the top states because it's a fairly sure pickup. But we should not be satisfied simply to change the D behind our next senator in South Dakota's name to an R. We should expect more. I want to say what I think our next senator in South Dakota and all of the senators should look like as far as candidates. First of all, I think the most important thing is integrity. It is absolutely vital that I be able to look somebody in the eye, talk to them, express myself, and that they can know with absolute certainty that I'm speaking the truth. Number two, I believe, is conservative values, rock solid conservative values. Somebody that believes in limited government, personal responsibility, and individual rights. And that is more than just a phrase to me. Because as conservatives, our absolute bedrock foundation is the fact that we live in the country, the only country ever formed on the planet, where our rights come from the bottom up, from we the people. We've stated, heard it here quoted before, and I'll quote it again because it's my favorite, kind of like a favorite scripture, my favorite portion in the preamble is where it says, we hold these truths to be self-evident. And that is what separates us. And that's why when Senator Cruz talks about we have no place to go, that's why that is. Because the United States is unlike any other country, and that's founded on conservative principles. Thank you all very much.
Well, Senator Roden, state senator, wishing to be promoted to United States senator, joined the ranks of Cruz and Lee, Rand Paul, and the rest. I just had my grandson, Ian, that the group heard about earlier this afternoon, over to Mount Rushmore for a terrific visit. He loves our presidents and our American history, and it was thrilling to have him see it for my wife, Donna, and me to take him. So here's the litmus test for you. If elected to the United States Senate, will you firmly oppose any effort to add Obama's face to Mount Rushmore?
The answer is yes. And I would say that I had the opportunity to be the first U.S. Senate candidate. Senate Conservative Fund sent out a pledge that they're sending out right now to defund or repeal Obamacare. I think I'm the first U.S. candidate, Senate candidate, to sign that pledge. So,
thanks a lot. Best wishes. You know, you were seeing him full face. I was looking at him in profile. That profile wouldn't look bad on the mountain your own there, Senator. All right, from Wyoming, they like to brag that Wyoming is what America was. Please meet State Representative Lynn Hutchings.
Thank you so much, Mr. Andrews. I really appreciate this opportunity. I'm really glad that there are a lot of lights up here so I can see how many people are out there. I'm a little nervous. I didn't expect to do this, but I, again, appreciate the opportunity. I'm Lynn Hutchings. I'm a representative in the Wyoming State Legislature. I am a follower of Christ, conservative Republican. The lights are dimming a little bit, and I can see that there are more people here than in my district. There's a theme that I keep hearing throughout this conference, and that is to remember, return, and restore. I am a lover of our young conservatives, and I think about them often, and I'd like to encourage them by saying the biblical worldview and conservative principles that we're trying to resurrect and pass on to you are great, tried, and true. These ideas can compete in the marketplace of ideas. Remember this, that these are the very principles that made our nation great. Immerse yourself in them, know them, be ready to give a bold answer for what you believe to all who ask. They will provide a strong and firm foundation for you to build on to help us restore this nation to the greatness that God intended. When we are gone, to the older conservatives, I'd like to say, because I've talked to some of the young kids today, we have to walk our talk. We have to be truthful. We have to be willing to mentor them and, again, just walk what we believe, and I think we'll have a better nation. Thank you for your time.
All right.
Representative Hutchings, thank you so very much. I don't know about you, but I have had it with being part of a movement that is composed exclusively of older white males. I'm sick of it. I'm going to some other summit next year. And now from North Dakota, where unemployment, the last I knew, was in the negative numbers, you put a spade in the ground to plant a rose bush in your yard and you may have oil. State Representative Kim Koppelman. Kim?
Greetings, thank you. Well, thank you, John. It's great to be here and it's great to bring you greetings from North Dakota. If you're not real familiar with our state, you're not alone. In fact, one of our favorite sons was a nationally renowned journalist named Eric Severide. If you're old enough, you might remember that name. That's back when journalists actually earned some national renown. And he once called North Dakota a rectangular-shaped blank spot on the nation's consciousness. And even today, when I introduce myself and people find out I'm from North Dakota, they say, I love North Dakota. I visited Mount Rushmore, and it was fabulous. And I have to remind them that's in my friend Larry Roden's state in South Dakota. It's a great place. But they have the faces on the mountain and that majestic mountain. We have the oil under the soil. And right now, we'd probably select that. As John mentioned, we have the lowest unemployment rate in the nation, the fastest growing personal incomes, a growing population that's recently hit an all-time high, and we have the best quality of life in the nation by a lot of rankings. I bring you greetings from the land of the longest running budget surplus in the nation, and and of course, I know you all say, well, that's because of oil, and we appreciate the oil, but that's not exactly true. In fact, without the oil, we'd have a booming economy and a budget surplus as well. An oil executive recently told me, if it weren't for a business-friendly legislature, there would be no Bakken oil boom. But the proudest ranking of all for North Dakota, in my view, is the one we just earned this year when we were named the freest state in the nation. And I like to think I played a small role in that. I'd been in business for a decade before being elected to the legislature 18 years ago. I enacted legislation to get a handle on regulation. And we've put you, the people, back in charge of government regulation through the people you elect to represent you in the legislature, which, after all, is the branch of government that is constitutionally mandated to make law, not the executive branch. And we're now working to help other states do that and also to help do it in Washington, where we need to remove power from Washington, bring it back to the states and the people as our founders intended and where it belongs. And just to give you a couple words about our recently completed legislative session, we lowered taxes again. That's becoming a habit in North Dakota that we're proud of. We passed some of the strongest pro-life legislation in the nation. I must confess, though, that in North Dakota, we do believe in gun control. It's called a steady grip and a firm grip and a steady aim. We also passed voter ID in the only state in the nation without voter registration, so that's very important. And let me close with this. It's a privilege to be with you. You are all leaders, whether you realize it or not, and I hope that you will go home and assume that mantle of leadership. In the words of John Quincy Adams, he said this, if your actions inspire others to dream more, to learn more, to do more, and to become more, then you are leaders. It's an honor to be in this room full of leaders. Thank you very much.
It's encouraging, isn't it, that we have legislators in neighboring western states of the caliber of Representative Kim Koppelman, North Dakota, Representative Lynn Hutchings, Wyoming, Senator Larry Rodin, South Dakota. I have to say that in addition to my embarrassment about being part of this older white male ghettoized movement, I am woefully tired of being part of a movement that can't do technology. If only someone here could text or Twitter, maybe we would be on the road to victory. But hey, I just got a text. Let's see. It says, Huck is in the building. All right. And before we bring him on, and it couldn't be more fitting, the connection, we want to honor someone who has been with us at the summit in the past. We're so delighted that they can be with us this evening for the Mike Huckabee festivities, because what they have done with their life as active citizens so beautifully matches what he's done with his life in public office and now in the media. She leads the National Day of Prayer. He is synonymous with the founding of Focus on the Family. What a giant institution. Recognize, please, special guests of Bill and Ellen Armstrong this evening, James Dobson and his wife, Shirley Dobson. Dr. Dobson, Shirley, we love you. America loves you. When the Mount Rushmore of taking back this country for biblical truth is carved, your faces will surely be there. Now, yes, more applause for the Dobsons. Thank you. I've said a couple of times I want you to look at our presenters this weekend and say, that could be me, and maybe it should. And I go home resolving to do more. Or perhaps you look at the younger ones and say, that could be some young person that I know, given the right kind of encouragement. Here's someone who had a small business. He worked some of his time in ministry. He served his country in uniform with distinction in the Gulf War. And one day he looked at Jefferson County, Colorado, and said, my community ought to have better representation in the Colorado Senate. It was not unlike Jim Geddes, the CU regent that we heard from this afternoon, who said, all right, there's a Republican there, but it would be great if there wasn't just a Republican, but a conservative, the very point that Larry Rodin made about his state of South Dakota. So here's someone who decided, well, I better do something about it. I'm going to light the candle, not just curse the darkness. I'm going to get inside the tin can, because that's the only way you get the dents out of that can, from the inside of the process. He went on to win an upset primary, to get elected to the Colorado Senate, to become its Republican minority leader. He today is trying to defend the rural electric industry against Barack Obama and John Hickenlooper's design, express design in the case of the president, to drive electricity rates sky high, all in the cause of their extreme environmental religion. He's a fellow as well of the Centennial Institute and a winner of our annual Zebulon Pike Award for Colorado leadership. To introduce Governor Huckabee, former Colorado Senator Mike Kopp.
Thank you. Good evening. Good evening, American patriots. Do we have anybody in the House tonight that is from another place other than Denver? Let me hear one more time, because I want John Andrews and Bill Armstrong to see that. If you're from somewhere other than Denver, let's see your hands and let's hear you shout. That is a testament right there to leadership. And I want to take just a moment before I have the distinct honor of introducing Governor Huckabee tonight to just say thanks to United States Senator Bill Armstrong, president of Colorado Christian University. And I'll give you a minute to clap again. And former Colorado Senate President John Andrews. These are two of America's finest conservative leaders, and we would not be here tonight had it not been for these two fine gentlemen. Please express your appreciation with me if you would. Make sure you grab them. Thank you for that. Make sure you grab them somewhere tonight and give them a big bear hug for doing that. I've been thinking a lot about the book of Ecclesiastes lately. There's this passage in there. There's a time for war and a time for peace. President Jefferson and war planners will say that in times of peace, you prepare for war. And the big idea there, friends, is as we mount up and we equip ourselves to take on the conservative issues of our day, that we do more than just mount up and prepare ourselves. When we're called upon, we put our boots on. That's big idea number one. Big idea number two is the winners get to determine the direction that the United States of America goes. You think about how profound that is. Now, if it's not us, who will it be? We can all join in a moment in thanking Governor Huckabee, who has exemplified this fight better than almost anybody that you can think of. An authentic leader. You always hear the word authentic when it relates to Governor Mike Huckabee. He hasn't been just talking about the American dream. Governor Huckabee has lived the American dream. From Arkansas, you might know that the governor was the first male in his family to graduate from high school. He went on to college, of course, to earn a degree. He got out of college and he went into pastoral ministry, and he began to defend the truth in that context. Within 10 years, he was leading the Arkansas Baptist Convention, almost 500,000 members. By 1993, he was the lieutenant governor of the state of Arkansas, which is no small feat in a state that had only elected three statewide Republicans prior to that since Reconstruction. By 1996, he was governing the state. 1998, he ran for election. He won election as governor. 2002, ran for governor, won the governor's race. 2008, who can forget the way he took Iowa by storm as a real heavyweight contender to become the president of the United States, beat a crowded field by 9 points. Governor Huckabee is the real deal. It's an honor to have him here tonight. You know him because he's on TV every week. He just got here from his TV gig. Excuse me. He's speaking to millions of people each week on the radio as well. It's a delight to have this good man, this husband, father, a Christian, a conservative, Governor Huckabee. We'll be right back.
Well, first of all, it is a delight to be here, and when I tell you that, I really mean it. I had a dickens of a time getting out of New York today, taped the television show for the Fox News Channel. In fact, I think it may be on now. Maybe we should put it on the screen instead of me. It took almost 50 minutes just to get from Midtown Manhattan to the tunnel and then over to Teterboro Airport, where I was leaving to get here. And then if you've ever flown in and out of the New York corridor, you just know that you're not likely to be on time. And so I sat on the ground there for another 35 minutes, and I'm thinking, I got to be in Denver, like, right away. If it weren't for the fact that I crossed two time zones, I really would have been late. I am also painfully aware that it appears that they have put before you salads and desserts, and you don't get to eat until I stop. Do you have any idea the pressure that puts on me? You know, Jesus never had a clock like that. If he had, there'd have been another beatitude: blessed are the brief, for they shall be invited again. I will be very mindful of your meal and the time here tonight. People ask me all the time if I live in New York, and I want to make it very clear, I most certainly do not. And I have no intention of living there. I commute there every week to do the television show. I tell people I will consider living in New York when Mayor Bloomberg will let me duck hunt in Central Park. Which is another way of saying I'm not going to be living there. Now, I like living where I still rub shoulders with people every day who lift heavy things and sweat to have to earn their living. I like to go to church with folks who are from all walks of life and from every culture and every race. That's who I am. It's where I've come from. And as Mike was telling you in the introduction, you know, I did not grow up understanding even how to sit at the head table. I knew how to work in the kitchen, but not sit at the head table. That's something I had to learn to do. And being the first male in my family that graduated from high school ever, even going to college was a real breakthrough in my family. I tell people sometimes the reason I love this country is because it has afforded people like me the opportunity to live way beyond the dreams that I ever had as a kid. And there are not many places on this earth where you can even dream it, much less do it. And one of the reasons that I'm so passionate about making sure that we get our government back in the control of people and not professional politicians is because that is the only way we are going to revive that American dream, so that the American dream doesn't become the American nightmare, where government is so big that it becomes the mother and the father of every boy and girl growing up. And those kids, rather than having their own dreams, will have one given to them by the government. That's a frightening thing. And there are many frightening things about our government today, although there's some good things even to come out of it. For example, I was going to sign up on one of those plans with my iPhone, where that if I lose it, I can go online and it'll be located. I can find out exactly where it is. I'm saving that money now. Because if I lose my iPhone, I'm just going to call the government and ask them, where is it? Because they seem to know. Well, recently, my wife and I went to Boston. I had a speaking engagement there, speaking to the Republican lieutenant governors. And so we went there the day early and caught a ball game at Fenway Park, which I think is the greatest ballpark in America for baseball. I know maybe not the Boston Red Sox. Don't hit me. I know you're Denver Rockies fans. But the ballpark, I mean, it's a shrine, 101 years old and is still a site of baseball. And it's old school, and that's why I love it. And I took some pictures, but it wasn't of the players. I took some pictures of the people that reminded me who's the hardest working people at that ballpark every day. And it reminded me what makes still America a great country. I snapped some shots of the vendors who were hauling hot dogs and peanuts and beverages up and down those stairs, because I watched them and I'm thinking, all day, before the game, all during the game, till the end of the game, These guys are jumping up and down those stairs. I'm watching them carry heavy loads all day long. And it's hot. And I realized some of those guys are carrying these heavy loads, making a little bit of money, hoping one day that instead of running up and down those stairs at Fenway, they'll be sitting in the seats. That's what America's about. It's about understanding that where we start isn't where we have to stop. But unless this country gets back on track, there are a lot of people who are going to have to stop where they started because all of the opportunities are going to be crushed on top of them. Now, I hear people say sometimes that Republicans lost in the last presidential election because America rejected our message. And I think that's completely wrong. With all my heart, I believe that is a wrong assessment of what happened. I believe the Republicans lost because America didn't know what our message was. And we did not translate it down to the average person who could understand what it was we were going to do significantly different than this current administration. I don't know if you happened to see the president's speech this week. If you missed it, it's still going on. He started it and he's still talking. 1 hour and 6 minutes. And it was not one thing in there new. Everything that he was saying is stuff that he said 5 years ago when he was campaigning. But there was one line in the speech that was memorable, and only one. Well, there were actually two. The most memorable line was when he said, "And in conclusion," because people in the audience actually awoke from their catatonic state. But the other line that was memorable was when he said that he was unable to get things done because of all of the phony scandals that were going on. And I think everybody in America is asking, which scandal does he think is phony? The 4 murdered Americans in Benghazi, is that phony? Not to the families of the dead Americans, it isn't. Is he talking about the IRS, where it turns out that they've targeted conservative groups, Christian groups, pro-life groups, pro-Israel groups, to slow walk their applications, to deny them, and to make it difficult for them to keep going? Is that phony? Is it phony that the National Organization for Marriage Donors was illegally leaked to the Human Rights Campaign, which is not just unethical, it's a felony? Is that a phony scandal? Is it phony that the Department of Justice gave out thousands of guns to Mexican drug lords that were eventually used in the killing of over 300 Mexicans and a border agent by the name of Brian Terry? Is that phony? Is it phony that the Department of Justice not only tapped the phones of reporters like James Rosen, one of my colleagues at Fox News, and the Associated Press, but then the Attorney General went to Congress and lied about it, said he knew nothing about it. Turns out his own signature was on the order that allowed it. But we can't spend all of our time focusing on what the president might call a phony scandal. We need to communicate that being a conservative is not a bad thing. In fact, it's a wonderful thing. Because it means that we value the work that Americans do. And the reason I say that is because rather than talk about our tax policy, we'll change the marginal tax rates. That doesn't really relate to a whole lot of people in this country, unless they're accountants. And I don't think we need to suggest that our constituency is limited to CPAs and tax attorneys. Now, the real issue is, does the government value what you do when you go to work every day, whatever it is? And the truth is, if the government takes a bigger and bigger piece of what you earn, then the government does not value what you do. It values what it does above what you do. Folks, we need to remind Americans that a tax on your income is the government deciding that what it is going to do with your money is more valuable than what you did to earn it. And I don't know many Americans, I don't care what they do, who believe that somehow the government's going to spend their money better than they could. And if they come home bone-tired carrying an empty lunchbox that once had a bologna sandwich that they had for lunch, and they come home and they're just worn out and they have to take a bath before they can even get to the dinner table because their wife won't let them get to the dinner table as dirty as they came home, I'm telling you, to tell that person your work doesn't matter, it's not that important because the government thinks it ought to have a bigger chunk of your paycheck. People tell me we don't have a message. That's the message of lower taxes. Your work has value. We need to tell the families of America that we value your freedom. And I'm not just talking about your freedom to live in what neighborhood you want to live in. I'm talking about the freedom that you ought to have to send your children to whatever school you believe will undergird rather than undermine your basic moral values, that ought to be a part so that it's not just the wealthiest people in the country who can afford to send their kids to the finest private schools, but the single mom who is struggling to be able to get her kids to school will have the choice and the opportunity to send her kids to a school that succeeds, not a school that has perennially failed every single year, and the students are below the national average in every percentile of reading and math and science. Why shouldn't that be an opportunity for every family in this country, whether they choose to homeschool, send their kids to a Christian school, or if they want to put them in a public school, let them have the choice. We value freedom, and we value the wisdom of a mother and father to make a better decision about their children's education than some bureaucrat in government would ever be able to make. That's our message to moms and dads. We want to tell American families that we value your dignity. We value the fact that as an American, nobody has a right to snoop into your private affairs, whether it's your tax records or your phone calls, or whether it's to put a hand on you just so you can board an airplane, even though you've never committed the crime. I'm on airplanes several times a week. Of all the things that really just creep me out, it's the thought that every time I have to get on an airplane, I have to first get in the surrender position as if I'm guilty until I can prove that I'm innocent, that I'm not really carrying a bomb or a gun. I understand we live in a dangerous world. We have to be safe. But we have taken the idea of security to a point that makes no sense whatsoever when we will inspect an 80-year-old woman in a wheelchair and make her take off her adult diaper, and we will inspect some 4-year-old who is disabled in a wheelchair and make them cry because we have some stranger who's putting his or her hands all over them when every mother and father has said, never let a stranger touch you. And then we have to tell them, but it's okay for this stranger to touch you. We need to tell Americans as a party, as a movement of conservatives, we value your dignity, we value your privacy, we respect the fact that as an American, there are some things you don't have to put up with because you are an American. We value that dignity on your part. We need to tell every American that we value your security, that you have the right to defend yourself. You have the right to protect yourself. You should have an expectation that the streets and neighborhoods and the parks in which your children play are going to be places where they are safe from predators. That is an expectation that every mother and every father should have, and we should make it clear that we value the safety and security of every American. And if a person wishes to protect themselves as guaranteed by the Second Amendment of the Constitution of the United States, then that is a fundamental American right that should not be infringed upon or tinkered with by somebody who has no idea why the Second Amendment was even put in its place. We should tell people we value their safety and their security. Part of our message to America is that we value their health. I'm not talking in an Obamacare kind of way, because that is exactly the opposite. When we say we value people's health, we mean that we value their choice to make the decisions that they believe are best for them, not have some bureaucratic panel that live 3,000 miles from them determine whether or not they're going to get surgery, whether or not they're going to see a doctor, and what doctor it's going to be. Remember when the president said that under Obamacare, if you like your doctor, you can keep him? Then we found out 60% of the doctors in America, because of Obamacare, are thinking about retiring. You can't keep a doctor that quits. And even the Health and Human Services Department last week came out and said, well, their language is no longer, if you want to keep your doctor, you can. It's, if you want to keep your doctor, you might be able to. By the time Obamacare, God forbid, but if it ever gets fully implemented, it'll be, you could have kept your doctor if he was still around. Let me tell you what it means to when we tell Americans we value their health. We value that they ought to pick their doctor. They ought to choose who they go to and who they trust. We value that their health, that if they believe that there's a certain type of coverage that they want and need, they should be able to buy that and not have the government tell them exactly what coverage they're going to have. Because it may be a coverage they don't need, can't afford, and they'd rather have a different kind of health coverage, not one designed by Harry Reid and Nancy Pelosi, who admitted they didn't know what was in the bill. Nancy Pelosi said, we won't know what's in it until we pass it. Forgive me for being crude, but that's as ridiculous as saying you won't know what you had for dinner tonight until you pass it. I don't think that that's really a good criteria for determining the health of America. We should let America know we value your family. And by the way, I don't think for one minute Republicans and conservatives are in trouble because we have unwaveringly stood for the sanctity of life for every human being from the moment of conception. It is nonsense to think that somehow that makes us unattractive. That is an insult to women of this country. And by the way, it's an insult to every single mom in this country. For someone to try to say that what she values more than being able to feed her kids, give them the hope of a good education and a good job someday and independence that maybe they never will have had because they were growing up in a single parent household, that somehow that those things don't matter as much as her being able to access a government paid for abortion and free birth control every month. That is an insult to every mom in this country. And it is absolutely beyond me that there are people who think that somehow the Republicans need to become a calorie-free version of Democrats and be afraid to take a stand for the life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness for every person, because we want to make it clear we value every life as having worth and value. There is no such thing in our worldview as a person who is disposable and expendable. Every person has life. Every person has value. Your child, his child, her child, every child has value. We need to make it clear that we value our allies. I worry very much about our place in the world. The few friends we have left, we act like we don't really want much to do with them. What we have done with the one friend and the one stable government in all of the Middle East, Israel, is deplorable. We have put more pressure on Israel to stop building bedrooms for their families in the land that God gave them thousands of years ago than the pressure that we've put on Iran to stop building nuclear devices. What is wrong with a country that doesn't value our allies? After the Arab Spring, we looked the other way and thought it was going to be just fine and dandy that the Muslim Brotherhood would take power in Egypt. We thought they were so trustworthy. We thought we could be sending them 20 F-16s and 200 Abrams tanks. After 2 years of their brutal, ruthless rule, in which they murdered Christians, burned churches, and systematically sought to destroy everybody that didn't want to follow a radical form of Islam, to the point that the people by the millions turned out in the streets and overturned the dictatorial rule of Mohamed Morsi, the president who said that Jews were bloodsuckers and the descendants of apes and pigs. That's a real peace lover for you. And so when he's ousted, did we have the same respect and admiration for the new government? No. We've said nothing. Nothing. What's wrong with us? Well, it's not what's wrong with us. It's what's wrong with the people in power. And we need to remind America that we value our allies, and we understand that it's better to make peace with strength in the alliances that we have with people who mirror our understanding of democracy and freedom and free speech than it is to ever trust or assume that radical terrorist jihadist groups like the Muslim Brotherhood will ever be able to be trusted with the lives of millions of people in any nation, any place, any time. We need to tell America another thing, that we value our military. And I want you to hear me very carefully, because I fear that something is happening within our military that is very disturbing. We're seeing military members who are being punished for being people of faith, told to stand down when it comes to putting a Bible on their desk, or expressing their faith openly, chaplains being told not to pray in Jesus' name. What are they supposed to pray in? I mean, I expect a Christian chaplain to pray in Jesus' name. I'd expect a Jewish chaplain, you know, to read the Torah. I would expect a Muslim chaplain to pray to Allah. I get that. Having the military to tell the Christian chaplains, however, not to mention Jesus, not to show a Bible. I don't understand this. If one of our soldiers does something that seems disrespectful to the Quran in Afghanistan, we discipline the soldiers and we send massive apologies from the State Department and the Defense Department. Let a soldier put a Bible on his desk and we castigate the soldier and we provide disciplinary action against him. What is wrong with a country that does not value the basic Judeo-Christian concepts upon which this nation was founded and all but apologizes for them, and now wants to create something that is absolutely oxymoronic called atheist chaplains? What is an atheist chaplain? What is that? Turning our military into a social experiment and ordering that the chaplains will have to perform same-sex marriages, even if it is against their conscience, violates the purpose of what the military was created for. It is not there to be a social experiment. It is there to keep the peace, make us free. And we need to let America know that we value our military, not as some front organization for some sociological experiment. We value the men and women who are willing to put on the uniform of this country and give their lives for the freedom and the future of the rest of us. And we've got a situation now where our president is wanting to cut the pay and increase the co-pays and the health care cost for our military. Are you kidding? Let's say, why don't we cut the cost of the president flying around on Air Force One, cut the salaries of the members of Congress, and raise the pay of the people in the military? And every veteran who has served deserves to have everything that was promised to him or her. If it requires the dismantling of the Washington Monument and we sell each of the stones as a souvenir to pay for it, if there is anyone in this country who deserves and for whom we should demand the fruits of our government, it is those who have served in our military. That, my dear friend, is something that we need to tell America we value. So So when people say, that the Republicans lost because of their message, my message to you is, it's because we never found our message. And when we do, and when we communicate what we're for, I am convinced that while not everybody is going to be with us, I believe that enough will be with us, that we will win the Senate next year, take back the White House in 2016, and one day make America, for your sons and daughters and your grandsons and your granddaughters, a place where they thrive rather than just survive. Thank you, and God bless you. An honor to be with you today.
Governor Huckabee, that was wonderful. If you could have been with us from last evening, you would know that this has been like a relay race where certain themes have been passed on as a baton by runners from great leaders in the political and thought life of America on the right, from Scott Walker to Mia Love, this morning to K.T. McFarland, Victor Davis Hanson, Mary Catherine Hamm, Ted Cruz. The relay went on. Charles Murray, did you hear the way the themes built until Governor Huckabee summarized so beautifully for us? Charles Murray, Dick Morris, Francesca Chambers, and the Young Conservative Leaders Panel. We have just given the baton to the man who carried it in winning fashion across the line and showed us how we can win again. We thank you so very, very much for that. Now, speaking of winning, Governor, we're doing a straw poll tomorrow for 2016. I think a lot of people just retroactively declared you the straw poll winner from 2008. Cold comfort, but we love you and thank you for what you did then and thank you for what you continue to do in the media. The reason the paint-spattered canvas is up here is that we have a fine art portrait that was done of you this afternoon, custom art, and here it is for the Huckabee Art Gallery when you get home. So, a long flight from the East Coast to here and home to Florida before he sleeps. Your long travel was well worthwhile. You have given us so much to inspire and push us forward. Thank you very much, Governor. And friends, now enjoy your dinner, please.